What would you say are the achievements and challenges in Namibia's almost 25 years of national independence, and what is the way forward from now on?
Fantastic. In terms of the almost 25 years of Namibia's independence, and as much as you may ask about the achievements, challenges that it faces, you see, at that age, that is 25 years of political independence, I'll simply state this. First off, I think it's very, very important to always bear in mind that Namibia's independence, unlike possibly many African nations, for Namibia, its independence came as an ultimate sacrifice on the part of Namibians themselves, that is, the nation's citizens, Namibian citizens. There was a lot of bloodshed that saw Namibia rise as a nation. And the only comparison possibly would be our neighbors in South Africa under the ANC, for Namibia under SWAPO, and PLAN, an acronym for the People's Liberation Army of Namibia. Now, why do I say this? Very simple. Yes, it is very true. It is fashionable, indeed, sometimes to say that Africans too were colonized. But to an extent that Namibians had to take up arms, which very few African nations can lay claim to, is a very important background to understanding the current achievements and challenges that face Namibians as part of the overall African reality. Now, the first achievement was the actualization and the handover of political power into the hands of an entirely new political dispensation outlining a free and liberated Namibia. That was the first achievement: freedom to a people that were in a cruel bondage, that were suppressed, oppressed, and bound to a status of second-hand or subhuman characterization. The achievements, secondly, was ushering in a constitution that has been lauded by the international community. You may be aware that Namibia's constitution, unlike many other constitutions, whether here in North America, whether in Europe, Latin America, is second to none. It encompasses and is drawn out of certain tenets, yes indeed, borrowed, you know, from the oldest constitution, encompassing freedoms, fundamental human rights, such as you see here in the United States. But then Namibia's constitution goes further than that. It is also rooted in what the world today are calling globalization. Was that premeditated? Was that by design? No, simply because Namibia happened to be in a situation where it was an international territory. Its custodians were the predecessor, that is, the League of Nations, the forerunner to what we call the United Nations Organization today. And so you could see the immediate benefits that Namibia, as a child of the international community, you can see how privileged Namibians became at independence, that they could draw from the traditional old constitutions of the world and still tap to what people are referring to as globalization today. So you can see how uniquely lucky, well, maybe not luck, but certainly, after so much blood shed, I think that was the ultimate reward that would necessarily crown Namibian people's glory. Now, to come to the achievements. Along the political journey from independence and 25 years of independence now, I think the most outstanding is the deepening and strengthening, solidifying and concretizing the democratic tenets ingrained in that constitution. There have been free and fair elections and smooth transitions from one administration to the other. The founding president and founding father of the Namibian nation, Sam Nujoma, served the constitutional 2 terms. And then Hifikepunye Pohamba emerged as his successor, again through free and fair elective processes. And after having now served his 2 terms that now are coming to a close, Pohamba is bowing out with dignity in the spirit of Namibia's constitution, in the spirit and appreciation of the democratic dispensation that prevails in Namibia. And possibly we are going to usher in a new administration to serve the Namibian citizens, the Namibian people, through democratic processes still existing. The peace, stability, and freedoms that prevail will usher in a 3rd president in the name of Hage Geingob. Now, why is this very important? It is very, very important, especially in the African context. First off, You only have to look at any African country, with the exception, possibly, of Botswana, our neighbor. With an exception of South Africa, our neighbor, to understand this political dimension of democracy, in trying to understand Namibia's achievements. When you juxtapose that to the rest of Africa, East Africa, Uganda, Kenya, Rwanda, Burundi, Malawi, Tanzania, West Africa, Nigeria, Ghana, Guinea, Equatorial Guinea, Mali, Senegal, the Gambia, the Maghreb, Morocco, Tunisia, Egypt, the Horn of Africa there, Djibouti, Eritrea, Somalia, Sudan, and indeed, the last African country to attain so-called independence, that is the South Sudan. Juxtaposed against all those nations, you can see how remarkably Namibia has emerged as a shining star, a nation that is the object of envy. You only have to look at the Central African Republic, at the democratic so-called Republic of Congo. You only have to look at Zambia, at Zimbabwe, and then you'll understand 25 years of independence, while Namibia is a very, very important and prime example of how Africans should be as proud nations, because Namibia has much to offer. Namibia has much to teach the rest of these ungovernable, unstable, some very violent nations, which have turned their backs and their citizens against democratic tenets. You only have to see the so-called fellow Africans that come from the continent. They live here in large numbers as victims of their own violent past, as victims of a lack of governance structures, of leadership structures, and more so, of democratic appreciation. We in Namibia, and I must say I'm proud to state this, are a wondrous nation in Africa. And we evoke African pride wherever we are. In terms of economics and economic development, in the short span of 25 years of national sovereignty, of national ownership of our resources, following defeat of apartheid, oppressive and suppressive forces, that's starved Namibian citizens, I have this to say, that first off, the economic leap that Namibia has demonstrated it cannot be measured, but in leaps and bounds. Also juxtaposed to other African countries that have been independent for as long as some of us have been alive. Some countries are 50, 52, 60 in most cases. But Namibia still remains unmatched in terms of economic achievements in all sectors. As in the rankings, the 2014 rankings of Africa's richest countries per capita, and even in terms of gross domestic product, Namibia is in the top 10 in Africa, at number 8. A remarkable placement, a remarkable ranking. Out of 54 old African countries that have existed longer than Namibia, you look at where we started 25 years ago. We were the last at the end of the pack. A deprived people, a black people that were denied any economic recognition, any human recognition, to be placed 8 out of 54 African nations, and coming from the back. And that is demonstrated by the amount of other Africans that on a daily basis seek to make a living in Namibia, running from non-states, running from little banana republics, running from failed states, failed economically, politically, socially, culturally, because that is what they are. And therefore, that is why we are ranked number 8 globally, through global eyes, looking at the African continent. But of course, economics is an everyday affair. Development is an everyday affair. Like Karl Marx and Lenin rightly articulated, development in dialectical materialism is that movement from the lower to the higher. Namibia set itself a vision, Vision 2030, to which our onward movement, to which we aspire to reach certain levels of economic and social and cultural development. And in all likelihood, I see an industrialized Namibia by 2030, in the spirit of the 2030 vision. And I can safely say to you that, as earlier pointed out, apart from South Africa, our neighbors, and Botswana, our neighbors, Namibia, at that time, 2030, will certainly be placed at first, at position number 1. the peace, the stability that continues in Namibia is a sure guarantee that Vision 2030 is going to be attained, and even much more. Now, as to the challenges, to revert to your question, as per Namibia's challenges, I have this to say. Challenges are not just the domain of Namibia. No. Challenges beset every nation in this global village, whether it's here in North America, Latin America, Asia, Europe. Challenges are there. But again, it is the manner in which a people confront their challenges, be it political, social, economic. And I can safely state here, without fear or favor, that again, Namibia is better placed in this regard. You only have to look at countries in Africa, whether it is Libya, Egypt, Nigeria, Ghana, Democratic Republic of Congo, Kenya, Burundi, to understand, or even Zimbabwe. They face challenges, but the manner they confront those challenges is what has brought these nations on their knees. In Namibia, in certain areas, we face challenges like any other African country or European country, be it Ukraine, Bosnia, Kosovo, Zimbabwe, Congo, Liberia. But we do not resort to our citizens being armed with machetes, running amok on the streets, chopping off people's hands, and willy-nilly shooting each other. No. And therefore, in 25 years, as much as there have been political differences, some of them very intense, no one, except possibly Meshack Muyongo, has resorted to attempting to kill other citizens. But that was quickly quashed, fortunately. And we all know where Muyongo is today. Yes. And very quickly, law and order was restored in a democratic fashion. And that would even have been a very good opportunity for any government, especially in Africa, to use that as an excuse to butcher the Caprivian people. But no, that did not happen. Muyongo and company left. They ran off in very peaceful measure. Had it been Rwanda, you see what happened to the Tutsis. Had it been in Democratic Republic of the Congo, you see what happens there. You see what happens in Central African Republic, in Libya, in Egypt, in Nigeria. But again, their sanity and dignity and integrity prevailed. And so, each year that passes, and as we face 25 years of nationhood, of political independence, it becomes apparent how political maturity and appreciation of democratic tenets and values are a natural phenomenon in Namibia. Now, economic challenges. Namibia is not immune, as pointed out earlier, to whatever besets any country in this world, be it recessions, inflation, you name it, unemployment, you name it. Whether it's here in North America, Europe, these are common problems that beset any economic activity, whether you're in private business. It's not donkey hurry every day. There are losses, there are profits, there are achievements, there are challenges. Whether it's in a political sense, here in North America or in Europe, there are political challenges. Ukraine, you name it, Russia, Latvia, Mexico here, Venezuela, you name it, any spot. But juxtapose that to Namibia. There's still a lot to smile about. We are way, way, way better and have demonstrated again that ability to absorb challenges and confront them. Social challenges, yes, they exist. It's social challenges of a human nature, of human frailty, of human weakness. Just like you have here, there are homeless people here, there's a lack of housing. In many nations in Africa, they have their kiberas, they have their all sorts of things. They are chibolias if you are in Zambia, Lusaka, for those that know Zambia, for those that know Congo, for those that know Zimbabwe. When you look at the Namibian case, the manner in which there has been an informed, deliberate effort, a movement, a confrontation of housing, for instance, that again is within the context of the 2030 vision alluded to earlier. Years in any nation's existence. Is not a measure upon which success can be gleaned. But Namibia, in that arena, has again overtaken a lot of nations by the organized manner in which issues, problems, shortcomings are confronted. I don't know. I think I've said so much. You may have some further questions, possibly.
Thank you very much, Mr.
Ndopu. Oh, you're welcome. Thank you. My pleasure. Thank you.